Do you have any practical advice on how I can improve my ability to concentrate and pay attention to the world around me? Well, I have some practical advice. Regulate your habits. Try to get up at approximately the same time each morning. I would recommend that you get up approximately when other people get up. So that would be something in the neighborhood of 7:30 or 8 in the morning, or perhaps earlier, perhaps a little bit later, but you want to stabilize that because your circadian rhythms operate more fluidly and your mood is likely to be regulated better if there's islands of stability in your daily routines. Human beings like daily routines, just like dogs like daily routines. And so regulate your sleep. I would say when you get up in the morning, eat breakfast. That's a really important thing to do. I can't tell you how many people I've treated in my clinical practice whose proclivity for emotional instability and depression, anxiety, general hopelessness, emotional pain and gloom and doom, as well as capacity to concentrate, were properly regulated or inhibited or reduced by merely ensuring that they ate a protein and fat-rich breakfast relatively soon after they wake up. And that's especially true if they're stressed. And because it turns out that if you stress yourself after a fast, which is of course what you've undertaken if you haven't eaten since the night before, that your body produces enough insulin to deplete the sugar in your blood. And then it's very difficult for you to become regulated properly with regards to your metabolism until you sleep again. And so it can be regulating your sleep and your breakfast eating habits in particular can be in a very effective way of regulating your mood and increasing your capacity to concentrate. The other thing I would say is that spending some time scheduling your time is also extraordinarily useful. And so I can tell you a little bit about how to use schedules effectively. Or the first thing I would say is that you should develop a long-term plan. You have to set up your vision, like Geppetto when he's looking at the star before Pinocchio's transformation takes place. You have to set up your long-term vision. You have some vision of the good towards which you're working and some vision perhaps of the hell that you're avoiding. And then I would say, once you set up that vision so that you know how to orient yourself, then you should start designing your days. And you can do that very effectively with a calendar like Google Calendar. And instead of, many people say, well, I hate using a schedule or I hate using a calendar. And what I would say about that is that if you hate using a schedule or a calendar, then you're probably using it wrong. What you're doing is using the calendar as an external tyrant that's telling you what you should do if you were going to be a conventionally good person each day. So you load yourself up with arbitrary, we'll say, arbitrary responsibilities. But that's not really how you should use a schedule. What you should use a schedule to do is to design the day that you would most like to have. And obviously that's going to include accepting some responsibility and undertaking to make progress on those things that you have to make progress on to keep your life from collapsing into chaos. But it should also mean that you schedule in activities that make you actually want to have that day. And so if you're using a schedule properly, that it can be your friend. And that can also be something that can increase your capacity to concentrate. And then I would say, well, if you're very scattered, then you can start to train yourself. You might say, well, I need to learn to read without distraction. So maybe what you do, you say, okay, well, for the next week, I'm going to read 10 minutes a day, and I'm going to try to limit the distractions. And if you're successful at that, then you could try 12 minutes a day. And if you're successful at that, you could try 15 minutes a day. And the trick is to set a goal for yourself that is slightly beyond your current level of performance, enough to be challenging, enough to be worthwhile if you accomplish, but not so difficult that you're likely to fail. And then practice incrementally, day by day, trying to inculcate the habits that you want to inculcate. And assume that it'll take you a number of months or even a number of years in order to become very fluent at the habit. The important thing is to start improving incrementally, because incremental improvement pays off like compound interest. And so I would also say that the trajectory that you're on is more important than your starting point. And that's also an extraordinarily optimistic observation, because it means that direction is more important than current position. And I mean, current position matters, obviously, but I don't think it does matter as much as direction. So if you want to learn to concentrate more, define what constitutes concentration, break it into micro habits, and then start practicing instantiation of those micro habits. Just take the problem at hand and decompose it into its micro elements, and then practice implementation of the micro elements. And that can be the inculcation of new habits, as I already mentioned, but that's also a great way of learning to face the things that you're avoiding, learning to confront the things you're avoiding that frighten you or that stop you in your tracks. So, you know, if you're scared of going to parties or maybe scared of going out in public, you can also always go to the nearest bar for 10 minutes and sit there and have a drink and then leave, you know, and then maybe expand that up to 12 minutes and then maybe dare at one point when you go out to say hi to someone. But again, don't ever underestimate the utility of incremental improvement. You can get a tremendous distance by engaging in incremental improvement. The first thing you need to do is to figure out what it is that you want. You need to understand where it is that you want to go in your life, and you need to understand what people would look like if they were the kind of people that you could surround yourself with to facilitate that goal. And then you need to start thinking through how it is that you would like to be treated and what your strategies would be, even in principle, if you find yourself not being treated that way. And then you have to start practicing that at the level of micro routine. I think one of the ways that you can do that is that you'll see that there are people who treat you in a manner that leads to the development of your resentment, feelings of resentment. And now there's roughly two reasons why you might feel resentful. And one is that you're just whiny and someone is calling you on your misbehavior, or you're failing because you should be failing and you're not, your character isn't well developed enough to merely adjust to the error and to fix yourself up. And the other is that you're being genuinely taken advantage of and that you need to put a stop to it. And the only way that you can really figure that out is by thinking it through or writing it down, or perhaps by talking to someone that cares for you in a positive way. Once you've done that, and once you've realized that you're resentful because you are being interfered with, then it's incumbent on you to say something so that it comes to a stop, and you'll have to practice that, and you'll be bad at it to begin with. You know, it might be that you interact with someone and you don't realize until hours later that you don't like the interaction and that you had something to say. You might have to sit at home and then figure out what it is that you should have said, and then go back and tell the person. You're going to be awkward and bad at it, but it's a good start. And maybe you need to write out why it is that you shouldn't be allowing people to mistreat you, so that you replace your habitual proclivity that was maybe instilled in you when you were a child with a thought through and mature philosophy of interpersonal relationship. That's a reasonable start. Wisdom seems to be something more like the balance between a large set of abilities and virtues. And there is no evidence that I know of that people with high IQs are wiser than people without high IQs. I don't see any evidence for that. So, and I think it's partly because your capacity to think can lead you into very bad places just as well, in some sense, as it can lead you into very good places. So it's a tool. It's a very, very powerful tool, and it's a tool that can be wielded for better or for worse, and even in relationship to your own well-being. I've seen many people whose intelligence and rationality has become nothing but the kind of critical force that completely undermines their capacity to live. It makes them nihilistic and bitter and resentful, and proud as well, because very intelligent people tend to be very proud of their intelligence, which is also a mistake, because they're not the creators of that intelligence and have no reason to take personal credit for it. So, but wisdom, whatever wisdom is, doesn't seem to be related in any straightforward manner to straight intelligence. It's necessary for a man, and perhaps for a woman as well, to become a bit of a monster, or even a lot of a monster, in order to move through life successfully. And that doesn't mean precisely that you have to act out being a monster, but it means that you need to be able to be a monster when the circumstances demand it. And so the reason that anti-heroes like Walter White, for example, are so popular in American culture is because the criminal Walter White was in no obvious way less moral than the conventional and cowardly Walter White. And it's the same idea that's expressed in Harry Potter. Harry Potter is actually able to combat Voldemort, who's essentially Satan for all intents and purposes, because he has a piece of evil lodged firmly within him. And it's also what makes him a redeeming rule breaker, right?